Houston, we have a heat wave right now. It is episode 7. We are continuing through the AFC South with the Houston Texans. The number 2 overall pick on the squad. What's it going to be? You're going to find out right here. And if we can't tell you what you want to hear and you want to go find out some other stuff for yourself, well, guess what? We have an app where you can find every single stat that you could possibly need, plus Broto exclusive stats that are proven to be better than the stats that are just traditional stats are all available right there. And it's all at the Fantasy Football by Broto app, and it's free. And the reason it's free is because of our wonderful, amazing patrons over at patreon.com/BrotoFantasy. If you support the show and you want to support us, please go over there for as little as $3 a month. You can join up and get access to so many things. We have so many extras. We have the Discord. We have the extra episode. We have the leagues and tons more extras that, honestly, we still have to give out even more extras. We have to have a think tank and say, what else are we going to give these wonderful, beautiful people? Because they deserve it. Patreon.com/BrotoFantasy. And you deserve some fantasy advice right now. So without any further ado, and I still have the problem with this ado. I've never heard ado in anything but the negative. But without any further of it, let's get started.
Tonight, yet another staggering heat wave striking
fantasy football.
Man, that heat wave music just hits different, even when you have been listening to it every single day. Maybe it might even grow on you even more every single day. Talking about growing even more, these guys grow on me every day, even though Michael thinks that he's muted right now and he's not, and he's just like sniffing and
I think you unmuted, right?
It is Michael. It is Matt. What is up, fellas? We got to switch you guys here. This doesn't even look. There you go. Michael, Matt, we got to take our positions. If you know what I'm talking about, it's youtube.com/BrotoFantasy. Editor-in-chief, your boy. Lead analyst and editor, Michael, and lead writer and director of content, Mr. The Dynasty Don, the Fantasy Encyclopedia, Matt Ward. I haven't pulled out Fantasy Encyclopedia in a minute, but people got to know. People got to know. This man just, like, last episode, just like, Drew Brees was the middle of the throwing. He just had it in the back of the head. Just keeps it there. That nice and tight. Do you know what's not nice and tight? The entire Houston Texans organization. They have been a joke. And D'Amico Ryans, their new head coach, is trying to change that. Now, obviously, he was a defensive coordinator, but for what it's worth, brings that no-nonsense philosophy after being a leader of the Texans the last time the Texans were relevant. I don't know if anyone remembers D'Amico Ryans, the absolutely phenomenal Pro Bowl linebacker for the Houston Texans. Sixth coach in the Texans franchise history, 3rd in 3 seasons. So it gives you an idea of how far they've fallen off the cliff. Last year was a 2022 Football Writers of America Assistant Coach of the Year. Now, I can give you all of how his defense did. He was a phenomenal defensive coach. But that we care about offense here for fantasy football. So who's running the offense? Oh, it's Bobby Slowick. Now, who is Bobby Slowick? He was the pass game coordinator with San Francisco. The most recent pass game coordinator before him was Mike McDaniel. So someone that's still a position that already has had some success last year. That's what that was his title. Slowick got a start with the 49ers the same season as DeMarco Ryans. Both coaches were defensive quality control coaches at the time. Slowick helped to manage a quarterback-friendly system for the 49ers, although it appears clear now that, you know, Mike McDaniel and Kyle Shanahan were the ones that running that offense. But there is something to be said about being part of that coaching tree. And they're hoping for anything better than what they got last year. Last year was a complete and utter disaster. 30th in points per game. 17 points per game. Ugh. What a disgusting number. 11th ranked pass percentage. They passed about 60% of the time, just under. And 21st ranked run percentage, just over 40% of the time. They did make some attempts to get better. They built the roster. They took their swings this year in order to get better because they are losing Brandon Cooks, who was their best player last year. But they're taking swings at some younger guys and some veterans. Robert Woods, who I mistakenly called 28 years old a couple episodes ago. Not 28 years old, but a veteran presence. Devin Singletary, another veteran presence that I'm going to be getting into later. Tight end Dalton Schultz, who they gave a good contract to. He's on a prove-it deal. You're going to see him probably be a big part of that offense. Offensive guard Shaq Mason. And on the rookie side, they drafted three young players. C.J. Stroud, of course, the quarterback. Wide receiver Tank Dell, who, according to some rumors, was recommended by Mr. Stroud himself. And rookie wide receiver Xavier Hutchinson. Again, I told you guys that the subtractions were a big subtraction in Dalvin Cook. Look, this is going to be Brandon Cooks. What did I say?
Dalvin
Cook. No, definitely didn't lose Dalvin Cook in Brandon Cooks. So, you know, once Cook, they're the cookers. They just cook all the time. They're like Matt. They're chefs. But yeah, anyway. Where was I? I completely forgot. Offensive outlook. Yes, let's get into these quarterbacks because I'm not transitioning well here. So just go. Someone save me from myself.
Okay. C.J. Stroud. Look, C.J. Stroud looked great at Ohio State, obviously, which is what made him the second QB off the board at second overall this past season to the Houston Texans. But unfortunately for him, he's heading to a team that still needs a lot of help. Last year, second-year quarterback Davis Mills was the QB 25 in points per game, despite actually being in the top half of the league in pass attempts per game. And he only had one game in which he surpassed 20 fantasy points, and that was Week 18 in a throwaway game against the Colts. And I know C.J. Stroud is not Davis Mills, obviously. You don't have to convince me of that. However, he's entering a similar team and landscape that Mills had last season. And Stroud does not have the rushing upside of Anthony Richardson or even Bryce Young. People just see a young athletic quarterback and expect it to be, you know, be able to run as well. His best rushing season was last year at Ohio State, where he ran just 47 times for 108 yards. Like he's not a runner.
I will say this though. And I know you're not supposed to be helmet scouting, but Justin Fields wasn't really a runner at Ohio State either. And you saw what Justin Fields did to the NFL last
Justin year. Fields also runs a legit 4.4.
I'm just saying this is not part of the when they had Justin 4-4. Fields, not they weren't running with Justin Fields.
Either way, CJ Stroud is not Justin Fields' speed though. Like
sure, but no, he could be used in a different way. That's all I'm saying.
Either way. He has limited upside as we know, as of now. Like, we'll see if that changes in the NFL, but as of now, he's never been a rushing quarterback. And his supporting cast is clearly not the strongest. Damian Pierce, Devin Singletary, Nico Collins, Robert Woods, John Mechie, Dalton Schultz. That does not scream huge upside. He's certain to go through growing pains. I mean, he is a first-year rookie quarterback, second overall on a bad team. His underdog ADP right now is QB26, FFPC ADP of QB28. I get it. His ADP is rightfully out of the picture in redraft leagues at the moment. In best ball, I do think he could have some standout performances, but he's not someone I'm going to be actively targeting in really any leagues this year.
Yeah, you could argue that this is, with especially the gifts he was given at Ohio State, you could argue this is legitimately the weakest supporting cast that he's ever played football with. And that's crazy to say about an NFL team, but he literally played with what is four NFL offensive linemen now, and five first-round NFL wide receivers
that have had success.
Yeah,
almost all of them.
Well, I am counting Marvin Harrison Jr. So yeah. Obviously he's literally going to be if it's not Caleb Williams, Marvin Harrison Jr. will go 1-1.
Are you counting Jameson Williams?
Oh, I mean that's six.
So even if you want to keep Jameson Williams another one, even though he hasn't
you, had it. No, you do count Jameson. Yeah, let's do that.
You got to, right?
Yeah.
It's just an embarrassment of riches. Embarrassment of riches.
Just transferred out?
Yeah, I mean, the quarterback is going to be the key to this team. But let's move on to the second position. I think the one that's being drafted the highest, and that's the running back position. Look. Damian Pierce completely boggles my mind as to why he is being drafted where he's at. I'm just going to tell you straight up right now that I just don't get it. He started this is year two for him. He was a rookie last year, started the year strong, but then completely fell off. 30 catches only as well. So definitely he's a plotter. He's a in between the tackles type guy. Didn't stand out.
Rex Burkhead targets before they were given Damian Pierce targets.
He didn't look the part. to be honest, like I know that we're going it's too simple sometimes to just say he didn't look it, but he just didn't look it. And when you look at a guy like that, when you draft a guy like that, it's TD dependency that is really the key, right? James Conner last year and the year before was completely inefficient and didn't catch many passes and was a plotter, kind of in the same way. But he scored touchdowns. He was 57th, Damian Pierce, last year in points per opportunity, excluding touchdowns, which is around that James Conner area. But look at the giant contrast between Conner. It's all about touchdowns. And the problem is he's a TD-dependent player on a team that's not going to score many touchdowns. And on top of that, he's not even the primary runner right off the bat. Devin Singletary joins the team. Devin Singletary has a very similar skill set to Pierce, except he's coming off his best statistical season, and his receiving stats improved drastically last year. Almost got 50 targets last season. And where he's going in terms of Damian Pierce, when you're talking about Damian Pierce, he's on a bad team with a rookie quarterback that's not going to score. And on top of that, he didn't play. He had like four good games last year. He had some RB2 finishes, very mid. His best game was mid after like a really strong 3-week stretch in the very beginning of the season when he first got the rock. And that's because he was seeing it so often, right? So you have that guy, and people are kind of still drafting him as if he's that guy at running back 21. Right now, according to Fantasy Pros. Let me tell you some guys that are ranked below him that I would take an ADP in a heartbeat before him. Alexander Mattison, 100%. James Conner, I would take. I would take Rashad White. David Montgomery's there, but I'm not sure if I would take him. I would take DeAndre Swift. Yep. I would take Isaiah Pacheco. I would take Alvin Kamara. I would take Javonte Williams.
Yep.
I would maybe take AJ Dillon.
No.
I would maybe take Khalil Herbert.
Yes.
I would maybe take some Samaje Perine as well.
No.
All right. So like that, I know that one's a hot take. That one's a hot take.
That was too far. But we honestly, like, there's about six running backs after Damian Pierce that I genuinely would take before him. What? Rashad being the number one of all those things, because you're basically asking the exact same thing. It's all volume and touchdown dependency.
Let me ask you guys a question, because I know I'm going to talk about this in the Vikings episode, but.
But he's in a committee.
What is with Alexander Madison's ADP? 22. What is going on? Why would you take Damian Pierce over Alexander Mattison in any world?
No.
You have a guy who is. Why? Why would you do it? It doesn't make any sense. In fact, Devin Singletary is going off the board at running back 40.
I was going to say it's got to be RB 40 something.
Yeah, 48. That's a much better value. Go get him in the 12th round and watch him outscore Damian Pierce this year. Now, even if I'm wrong and Damian Pierce is the main guy, you're still talking about a running back in a terrible offense with a rookie quarterback and really no offensive weapons on the outside to like really be super scared of. We're going to be talking about that in a second.
It's the same thing with Damian Pierce last year with all the – like Damian Pierce is one of the biggest talking points all of last season. I was like, what's really going to happen is that it's not going to matter if you draft Damian Pierce. He's not going to be a league winner. He's not going to be the reason you lose your season either, because he's a mid-round pick. It's just going to end up not mattering, really. Like, Damian Pierce isn't a league winner, period. It's not going to happen on this team, so I don't want to draft him.
You're talking about a guy in the fifth round. That could sink your team, bro.
You know, that's what, like, I'm not drafting him there. It makes no sense.
Yeah.
I'm in a long draft right now that someone just took Damian Pierce. And I'm just I'm like, thank you. Thank you for that gift. Damian Pierce is one of those ticking time bombs that you just want to leave there. Just like, let this ticking time bomb sit there. Let someone take him. Like, yes. Wasted roster spot. Let's go. You know, because I just think there's no way Damian Pierce returns on RB21. There's no way. There's 0% chance.
The thing is like the best case scenario is that he returns only that. Like, there's no upside to that pick at all. It's just the best case scenario is he's RB20 in points per game, in my opinion.
For me, it's stay the heck away from Damian Pierce and take a shot on Devin Singletary in the 12th round. Like, that's my official advice on this one. I don't think that's going to change much as we get into the offseason. So the running back room is, you know, an avoid, according to me at least. How do you guys feel about it? Would you guys say, if you had to rank it on the avoid scale to get the hell out of here at the front. And no, let's stay safe and draft him where his ADP is at in terms of like 1 to 10. Like, where are you guys at in terms of stay away from Dameon Pierce?
I'm like a 7.8.
Yeah, give me like a 10. I'm just not drafting him. I don't think there's any reason.
Yeah, me either.
Like, so we're at his ADP, of course.
So we're at,
never going to be playing in enough leagues where I'm ever like, I need this exposure.
Consensus. Brutal consensus.
No, with exposure, I'm going to have zero Dameon Pierce.
That's what I mean. Like, I'm never going to be – I'd have to play in an infinite amount of leagues.
So let's get to these wide receivers then. Maybe a couple of sleepers in here. How we feeling?
I mean, I thought we were only supposed to talk about fantasy relevant players, but I also think that since I do the dynasty stash on the Heat Wave, you could literally name this entire roster and be like, yeah, they're cheap enough, that's for sure. Obviously, the hype comes behind Nico Collins the most. Third year in the league, showed a little bit of upside when Brandon Cooks wasn't there, maintained a little bit of that target share upside when Brandon Cooks was there, but it's just a horrendous offense. And it's not like it really translated into anything. 33 receptions as a rookie, up those numbers to 37 as a sophomore. We're like, what are we getting so excited about? 6.0 points as a rookie, 9.7, which was wide receiver 49 as a sophomore. And 36 players under the top 36 players, sorry, in any positive peripheral stats, like he's outside of the top 36 in target share, outside of the top 36 in yards per route run, outside of the top 36 in team yards per team pass attempt. At 6'4" and 215, he certainly looks the part of a wide receiver one, but his play across the past two seasons suggests he's, in fact, much smaller contributor than his size reflects. And then you have Robert Woods coming in, obviously from the Titans, off of his worst statistical season in his entire NFL career. A lot of that coming to do with injury. But again, as we talked about in the previous episode with the Titans, like, there no wide receiver was really going to succeed in that offense, especially after Tannehill went down. They really bottomed out towards the end of the season. But he's also the only receiver on the Texans offense to have more than 70 targets and more than 50 receptions in a single season. Like, that's how either inconsequential, untalented, or new to the NFL this Texans wide receiver room is. Woods brings a committed understanding of the offense. He's worked with the offensive coordinator before, obviously a veteran presence, mentorship to one of the weakest wide receiver rooms assembled in recent memory across the NFL. And he's at the tail end of his career, sure, but he still can put together productive games and could probably lead the team in targets, but I think that's going to come down to the guy that Mike will touch on in a moment. And while I'm here, like, I will just mention the dynasty stashes, because it's John Mechie and Tank Dell. Like, it's both of them. It's take your shot at it, like, whatever. Mechie was highly productive slot receiver out of Alabama. He projects to be inside of the slot again. All reports surrounding his health concern, as many may forget, he was diagnosed with leukemia, didn't get to play his rookie season. They've all been incredibly positive. He's working at OTAs. He's been in all voluntary drills. He's completely cleared by the team doctors to resume on-field activities, and he's participating in training camp. There's unmitigated hype surrounding Nico Collins, but obviously he's going to function on the outside. Mechie will be on the inside, but that's exactly where Tank Dell is going to dominate too. And Tank Dell was a much more productive slot receiver than John Mechie ever was. Sharing that Alabama offense with Jamison Williams obviously isn't going to do you any favors, but every second of the route is a separation opportunity for Tank Dell. He's so fast and quick twitch. And he ran like a mid 4.4, but if you watch his film, and I'm not, I always resort to analytics first, but Tank Dell's fast, man. And he plays much faster than even a 4.4 suggests. He's going to line up inside of the slot as well and could easily push Mechie out of that position immediately and kill all of his value. They essentially are going to cost the same thing. Late third, you might throw a fourth and get Mechie. He's getting dropped in some leagues as people make roster clears as well because they haven't seen anything yet. But Tank Dell is the real deal, at least from a pure analytics standpoint. He's also only 5'7 and 170 pounds.
I will say I just drafted Tank Dell in a dynasty league, and I'm pretty happy about it.
I mean, he checks every box for an analytical purpose, like 40 touchdowns, you know, 2,000 yard season. Like, he definitely did it at Houston. But
all right, Matt, rolling in the deep, choose a Dell or Delicious.
Delicious for sure. What the come on, hell was son. That first one?
Yeah, Michael's talking about he
it's
got good
dynasty stash, bro. You're rolling in the deep. Dynasty stash.
Okay, that's a little bit better.
Yeah, now I get it, actually.
It still sucks. YouTube.com.
if I had to explain, then fine.
YouTube.com/BroFantasy if you want to see what the hell we're talking about. Michael, tight end.
From this offense.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
Mr. Dalton Schultz. Dalton Schultz going off the board at tight end 14 on Underdog, tight end 12 on FFPC. Behind Chigakonkwo, which I already mentioned in the last episode, is just blasphemous. Look, Dalton Schultz basically signed a one-year prove-it deal with Houston this year worth anywhere between $6.5 to $9 million based on incentives after not getting what he thought he deserved on the open market. Look, Dalton Schultz has flashed some real tight end one ability in the past. He's just 27 years old, but his 2022 season, it was his worst season since his 2019 breakout after a standout 2021. Last season, Schultz caught 57 balls on 89 targets for 577 yards and 5 touchdowns. That was a year after going 78, 808, and 8 on 104 targets. Despite this drop-off, he was still a top 10 tight end in points per game, which we know isn't saying that much, but still consistently top 10 in points per game. And Schultz did have 5 top 5 games as well, which exemplifies the upside that we chase when looking at the tight end position. While he's no longer catching passes from Dak Prescott, which of course is going to hurt a little bit, he will have less target competition in Houston, which means he, at the very least, should meet the 16% target share, which he's remained steady at over the last two seasons, and will likely surpass it. And I wouldn't be surprised if he reaches a 19, 20% target share this year in Houston with the weapons surrounding him. So
that
if you're
it's a tight end with 20% target share, like
that's not that crazy.
I mean, he was at 16% the last 2 years, and
especially
there are better weapons there.
I know D'Amico Ryan's going to want to run the football, but when you project how many pass attempts they had and how much of a learning curve that defense still needs, although they have young assets, they're probably going to be playing from behind a lot. If Houston has 400 pass attempts, they have it's going to be a lot of Dalton Schultz because they don't have a running back to check down to. They don't have an inside threat. They don't have a capable outside threat.
Yeah.
So a rookie
if you're not
quarterback loves the tight end. We know it. It's proven.
Yeah. That too, if the CJ Stroud finds a connection with Dalton Schultz early and often, I wouldn't be surprised if that remains for throughout the season. And look, if you're going to wait on tight end, you don't get a Kelce, you don't get a, you know, Mark Andrews, a Kittle, or any of those top end tight ends, and you end up with Dalton Schultz on your team, I get it. I think it's a safer route. I don't think he's going to be a top three tight end by any means, but I don't think he's going to shit the bed either.
Michael, you have a unique way of turning me. I think you're making me a Dalton Schultz
fan. I really like Dalton Schultz this year. I liked him always just in a high-scoring offense in the Cowboys. He proved to be a pretty good option, obviously fell off a bit. But I think in Houston, he legitimately could lead the team in targets. That's why I was saying, like, this is the most important position on this offense this year.
Even the worst team in the NFL, offensive-wise, scores 2 touchdowns a game. Worst
17 team. Last, yeah, 17 last year, so 2 touchdowns and a field goal.
Someone's got to do it. Devin Singletary, Damian Pierce, wide receiver options, Dalton Schultz. He's done it before, right?
He is the most proven fantasy asset on the team, at least in recent memory. Easily. Robert Woods, like as far as legacy goes, for sure.
I mean, 13 touchdowns over the last 2 years is nothing to scoff at either.
And I would say all-time fantasy, Dalton Schultz ranks on the all-time fantasy list over Robert Woods.
No.
I think if there's an all-time greatest fantasy players, Dalton Schultz would be
you're
over
crazy.
Robert.
No, yeah, what are you talking about? Robert Woods had two or
Robert
three
Trees
top
a Pro Bowler.
he had a couple top 15 wide receiver seasons.
Talking about
a couple tight end five
him ahead of Cooper Kupp.
Yeah, but you're talking about a tight end five season. That's a valuable thing.
Get out of here, man.
That's a valuable thing. That's all I got to say about that. @BrotoFFTim if you want to yell at me about that take. @BrotoFFMike, @PsychWardFF, @BrotoFantasy for the entire podcast. FF by Broto for the app and everything involved in the app. BrotoFantasy.com, YouTube.com/BrotoFantasy if you want to see our beautiful faces. And Matt's bright yellow NBA champion Denver Nuggets hat. Yep. All right. Jokic signed Denver Nuggets.
This is the Murray one.
Oh, Murray. My bad. But anyway, we'd love to see your face, kind of, virtually. We'd love to for you to see our face is really what I'm saying. It's kind of weird. But this 2023, this is what it is.
Big hat,
it is a big hat. You should come check it out. Big hats. Later.